Glory to Ukraine. Glory to the defense.
Слава Україні, слава силам оборони і смерть ворогам.
My name is Fakhruddin Sharafmal, and I'm speaking with Andriy Vydurinsky, a legal analyst, to discuss international law. Andriy, good to see you. Farid, good morning. Today, we have three topics to discuss with our viewers. Let's start with a topic that was in the media all day yesterday and is still being discussed today, the transit of Russian gas through Ukraine. Shmyhal said that Ukraine will not extend this contract for the transit of Russian gas to Europe. In 2021, Ukraine received $1 billion for this transit in total. Do we have the ability to find this extra billion? I was watching the statements about gas transit yesterday and remembered Fico's words when he said that he would ask Ukraine to keep this transit. Judging by the warm statements that Fico made yesterday, this refers to the launch of the Bratislava-Kyiv train, the allocation of 400,000 euros, the creation of an energy hub, support for joining the European Union, and so on. Maybe it's not so simple with this transit. You ask yourself difficult questions in the morning. How to compromise with your conscience, whether there is a dollar or a billion that can soothe a person's conscience so that he or she can sleep peacefully. I'm actually joking, but it's just a reflection of the sarcastically overwhelming number of arguments made by some Ukrainian rhetoricians, satirists, and sophists about how bad or how unacceptable it is to carry out transit. Shmyhal made two statements about natural gas. The first one is that we will not transit Russian gas, and we will not extend the contract in which Gazprom is the counterparty. Ukraine plans to create an Eastern European energy hub with neighboring countries, focusing on the joint use of underground gas storage facilities, including those in Ukraine. This raises a logical question for the average Ukrainian. What will we store in these facilities? It is unlikely that liquefied natural gas from the United States will arrive at ports in Spain or Greece and then be reversed to Ukrainian underground gas storage facilities to be withdrawn or lifted from the reservoirs for use in winter. Simply, the price of such a resource at a certain point in time will become extremely burdensome for the economy and profitability. So in theory, we can talk in this vein, because we don't know yet whether any firm agreements have been signed, or rather they have not been signed, because otherwise they would have been announced. But we do know that Mr. Shmyhal met with Mr. Fico to develop a roadmap for a coordinated action plan. At least that's what his Telegram channel says. If we try to interpret these words in relation to energy infrastructure and natural gas, it is most likely that we have natural gas storage facilities in Western Ukraine. In particular, gas that transits through the territory of Ukraine can be pumped into it, with the subsequent possibility of this gas being taken by Eastern European countries, such as Hungary, possibly Slovakia, and possibly partially Poland. In addition, we should not forget that theoretically, we used to export gas to Moldova, or rather, transit it. We don't want to miss this opportunity, as Turkey may take it with its gas hub, which would result in Ukraine losing another infrastructure advantage. The transit gas resource pumped through Ukraine supports the pressure needed to supply gas to heat and power utilities, commercial entities, and individuals.
Використовується в тому числі для забезпечення свого населення Ну, тому що фактично транзитний газовий ресурс, який перекачується через територію України,
otherwise we will have to reverse this process and create pressure not from east to west, but from west to east, using our own resources.
Постачати газ і на підприємства теплокомунальної сфери, і на підприємства фактично юридичних.
Therefore, in addition to money and dollars, we are also interested in not turning our gas transportation system around, as this will have to be done not through virtual reverse, but through real reverse. Given that we are planning to create a hub, at least three countries should be interested in it, so that it can be one of the projects financed, in particular, by the European Union.
То в хабі мають бути зацікавлені щонайменше три країни.
In conclusion, due to the usual lack of clarity and secrecy, we must continue to endure these conditions. History is likely to repeat itself, similar to what happened with the oil product pipeline used by Eastern European countries. Initially, it transported Russian oil, but later switched to Central Asian oil.
Вимушені, власне кажучи, боротися і миритися з такими умовами для існування. Скоріше за все, буде повторена історія. Чи намагатимуться повторити історію, яка відбувалася з...
They said, okay, we are transiting, but on the eastern border, or rather on the border with the Russian Federation, a European company becomes the owner of this oil. And once a European company becomes the owner, we are no longer transiting Russian oil, but European oil. And the same will happen with gas, give or take. As far as I remember, it was said that while Kazakhstan was the exporter of oil, I think Azerbaijan was the exporter of gas. In fact, our gas resource will be of Azerbaijani origin, and perhaps such an agreement will be reached on the eastern border of Ukraine, and the ownership of this gas will be transferred from an Azerbaijani trader to a European one.
У нас фактично ресурс газовий буде, ну, азербайджанський. На східному кордоні України, можливо, досягнеться така згода. Його власник, ну, власність на цей газ буде переходити від.
And then European gas molecules will start moving in Ukraine, and we will get not $1 billion, but €1 billion, or €900 million, if the exchange rate does not change.
Ну, або 900 мільйонів євро, якщо курс не зміниться.
Given that there are different periods of purchase and, say, high prices, high demand, low prices, low demand, you can use this complex dependence that exists in Eastern Europe on pipeline gas as an element of pressure in negotiations, or say as an element that allows you to reach an agreement that they store part of their resource in our underground gas storage facilities. Here I think there will be Austrian traders, first of all, who are also interested in having gas resources supplied under long-term contracts, still for the needs of their industry.
Австрійські трейдери, які також зацікавлені в тому, щоб ресурс газовий надходив по довгостроковим контрактам.
They can use a part of our underground gas storage facilities to preserve their own resources purchased during periods of more loyal prices. Under such conditions, we will be able to communicate that it is important for the public that this is not Russian gas, but European gas. As a matter of fact, we have been living on European gas, Swiss gas, if I'm not mistaken, for many years now. Deposits were found in Switzerland, and we have now had the opportunity to use it for a long time to meet Ukraine's needs. We can confirm that we no longer have financial agreements with Russia, and Gazprom is no longer a counterparty. Our dependence has been overcome. We are now a transportation company integrated into the European energy system and have ensured constant demand for gas storage services. The constant pressure in the gas transportation system, GTS, helps avoid excessive maintenance costs and saves citizens money. Changing the direction of gas flow would increase costs and affect the reliability of gas supply for cooking and heating. Ideally, the logistics component of the gas tariff shouldn't rise because companies like Ukrtransgaz must maintain the infrastructure. If transit fees are lost, ensuring pressure in the GTS for domestic needs needs becomes essential, requiring us to find funding in the domestic market. If we can implement this option, it allows us to pragmatically pursue our interests and interact more closely with countries with complicated political relations.
Укртрансгаз чи магістральні газопроводи, як вони зараз називаються, треба якимось чином утримувати. І якщо втрачається експортна виручка у вигляді оплати вартості транзиту, а транзит, чи вірніше забезпечення тиску в ГТС потрібне для того, щоб забезпечувати внутрішні потреби, то ви десь оцей мільярд плюс-мінус повинні знайти на внутрішньому ринку. Тому ми, власне кажучи, мені здається, якщо вдасться цей варіант.
We are trying to correct this by looking for, and here I quote our Prime Minister again, a new pragmatism in relations in international politics, not symbolism, but pragmatism. I can only welcome such initiatives, because pragmatism is something that we have been lacking in international politics for a long time. Ultimately, we will be able to see how intensively this will develop and how pragmatic this approach is only over time. Because in December or January, there will certainly be many more interesting changes that will take place, not only related to what is happening inside our country, but also to what is happening in the world, in particular in our partner countries. Josep Borrell says that, in fact, everyone wants the war to end, but no one knows how exactly this should happen. In theory, everyone knows how it should be, but no one wants to admit that sooner or later it will happen. These are negotiations on terms that are not very favorable for our country, a complex topic that is not customary to talk about, not customary to discuss on television or in social media, because you will be considered a city madman.
Ніхто не хоче визнати, що це рано чи пізно станеться. Це переговори на не дуже вигідних умовах для нашої держави. Це складно.
This is, in simple terms, a freezing of this confrontation and attempts to recapture the territories, but through diplomatic means. I'm more than 70% sure, let's say, I'm not going to say 100% sure. Let's leave 30% just in case as a retreat route.
Я впевнений, більш ніж на 70%, скажімо так. Не берусь сказати, там 100, там 99,9. 30% залишимо так, про всяк випадок, як шлях відступу.
Friends and partners are considering this option and see it as the only possible way out of this war. When we discuss a freeze, it implies that Russia will pause before launching another attack. Guarantees and treaties are being signed, and discussions about Ukraine's NATO membership are ongoing. What are your thoughts on this? You know, if our program was not shown periodically and then in a nationwide format, I would have been rather harsh. But since there are such chances, we cannot be baked. I would recommend that these Protestants who oppose everything look in the mirror. They can be unified under the formula Movement Against Surrender.
Люди, які загалом можна їх уніфікувати під формулою рух проти капітуляції, в тому числі серед представників попереднього п'ятого президента Петра Олексійовича Порошенка.
Including among representatives of the previous fifth president, Petro Poroshenko, his relatives and friends, who once headed the Prosecutor General's office and periodically write about surrender scenarios. I would advise them to ask what they were doing from 14 to 19, if not fighting a war in a diplomatic format.
Як не війною в дипломатичному форматі чи на дипломатичному фронті. Щось я не пригадую з 14 по 19 рік, щоб Петро.
Honestly, I don't recall Petro promising to militarily deoccupy Luhansk, Donetsk or Crimea during his presidency. It moved in a diplomatic format, the Normandy format, the Minsk format. The issue of agreements is not something new for us. And these people who allow themselves to make such statements are hypocrites in relation to the events of today, the circumstances on the battlefield, The situation the country is in terms of economy, demographics, and the future in general, the existential existence of the state. They are simply using similar rhetoric, not in terms of enlightenment or seeking understanding and a way out of the situation, but for the sake of some ephemeral political opportunity to take the places they do not occupy today. That is why I am very sorry that, unfortunately, the war did not bring common sense back to the minds of our politicians. Not everyone has fully realized that sometimes, as a result of war, there may be no politics at all in a certain country, at least not one that would be of a national and sovereign nature. Hence the understanding of what our partners are talking about preserving sovereignty as an important element of state building and state existence. Maybe the issue of integrity should translate into preserving sovereignty in communication. I believe these are categories that are inaccessible to some of the population and politicians who risk and lose nothing, as their lifestyles have changed little since the pre-war period. Regarding Mr. Borrell's statement that Ukraine would last only 15 days without support, I wonder if this is just a figure of speech, or if they understand that support arrives every 2 weeks as individual ammunition, depleting our resources and hindering stockpiling. This prevents effective combat coordination and makes it impossible to shift operations beyond deterrence due to insufficient resources. Again, we return to their rhetoric of deterring the enemy or exhausting it. Deterrence and attrition occur when the enemy halts its offensive or finds the cost of achieving its goals too high. This differs from deoccupying territory. Currently, the rhetoric of deterrence lacks the optimistic notion that once Russia is exhausted, we will provide enough weapons, money, and personnel to defeat it near the Kremlin. We are essentially being asked to continue the war until Russia ceases its offensive actions, followed by negotiations. There is no option on the table that our partners support for the deoccupation of Ukrainian territory through military action. These issues are evident and acceptable in the international press discussing realistic war goals. Recently, it was reported that part of Zelensky's team, along with the White House, is exploring negotiation options while maintaining security guarantees. These guarantees serve as a means to stop hostilities and prevent them from spreading to regions like Dnipro or Odessa. Розглядають можливості чи пошуки варіантів переговорів для того, але водночас зі збереженням гарантій безпеки. Гарантії безпеки – це інструмент припинення бойових дій. Цей інструмент дозволить цим бойовим діям не перекидуватись на території інших областей і не охоплювати Дніпропетровську область, не охоплювати Одеську область. This is a guarantee. So in this sense, we are actually in a rather confusing mental situation in which the slogans that satisfy contradict common sense and the circumstances of reality. The slogans sound like this: we do not trade in territory. But no one is talking about trading in territory. That is, even the scenario, if it were on the table, which would relate to the country's membership in NATO, does not provide for this. The extension of the fifth article to parts of Ukraine doesn't mean excluding any territory from the Constitution. This scenario still requires negotiation with the Kremlin for approval. Therefore, while we see this as a negative outcome, it might be the most optimistic option besides receiving $1 trillion in financial and military aid for deoccupation. І військової техніки для деокупації території. Ну, але цей варіант, по-моєму, геть взагалі ніде не обговорюється. But this option, in my opinion, is not discussed anywhere at all, although it is one of the best options. Therefore, in fact, from the position of Mr. Borrell, I conclude that communication on the format of the end of the war will be conducted not by institutions such as the European Union, but by individual leaders of sovereign countries. And perhaps within this format, there is appropriate rhetoric from German representatives, both opposition and coalition, or the introduction in the press of this, or let's say, similar rhetoric, a broad context about taking into account security factors on the part of Macron, which was voiced, or certain theses of representatives of the Republican Party from the United States, who are claiming to occupy the White House. Ending the war requires not only Ukraine's consent, but also understanding from the Russian Federation and its perceived enemy, the NATO alliance, which includes the United States and European countries. And in this context, it is a multi-layered negotiation. Today, we had an interview on 60 Minutes, not with the Russian channel, but with CNN, I think, with Kamala Harris. In which she says that she will not talk to Putin about Ukraine without Ukraine. It appears that the three are open to negotiating with Ukraine, with Kamala Harris taking a softer stance than Biden. She suggests that if Ukraine expresses willingness to engage in trilateral talks, she is open to it. Conversely, she doesn't clarify whether the U.S. would engage with a nuclear power on arms reduction treaties. Trump's comments imply a willingness to talk, indicating a potential shift in U.S. negotiation dynamics. A trilateral format could be feasible, not necessarily at the top official level, but through special representatives or national security advisors. Have we forgotten about Kurt Walker? It's hard to believe Andriy Yermak hasn't met with Kozak, especially since Yermak considers himself a national security advisor. There are formats and mechanisms for dialogue, but if the parties can't resolve the issue, they need to discuss how to do so. Mr. Borrell, it seems, is not opposed to talking. Again, it all comes down to this. If we stick to Harris, all the statements that are made, whether about accession in parts, or about trade in territories, or about negotiations, readiness for negotiations, or rather in a trilateral format, let's say, when Kamala Harris, Putin, and Zelensky sit down, are a form of how everyone interprets certain statements by different politicians for themselves. This is the trouble, I think, because they speak directly, and we start to guess what is going on and what was meant. She said, "I wouldn't sit down at the negotiating table without Ukraine." So let's come from the Russian side. Yesterday, Peskov was asked a question at a regular press event about the German scenario for ending the war in Ukraine, conditionally with NATO providing guarantees on the territory, but including the country as a whole in the North Atlantic Alliance. Peskov said that this is unrealistic and impossible from the point of view that the war will last until the goals are achieved. Well, in their case, the SDO, and in our case, the war. So through his lips, Putin rejected this scenario. So, in principle, the talks in our understanding that we will be granted membership or candidate status in the North Atlantic Alliance are already being heard and discussed from the position that we do not agree to this. They stupidly do not take into account the other side, which is waging a war, which also considers security guarantees as one of the elements that eliminates the need or possibility of continuing the war or hostilities.
В рамках Стамбульського формату колись
The Istanbul format once envisaged a mechanism for communication or dialogue between the guarantor countries to prevent possible provocations that could lead to another war. We have 30 agreements that have been signed and are coming into effect, which means that certain security assurances are provided when and if there is another attack. I am very sorry for the people who take it upon themselves to comment on certain events. Do not even receive basic training in reading the documents they have to comment on, despite the fact that these documents are publicly available and written in Ukrainian. So these illusions and interpretations are based on how these words have been interpreted by people who do not understand what they are interpreting. And then we have a distorted worldview. This situation is useful in countries with strict information control, where citizens need guidance. They look to their authorities for an alternative virtual space to escape into. However, the sugar regime won't make this opportunity available to everyone, so they should do what they can to satisfy citizens.
Ми давно вже хочемо в мету перебратися, але Цукерберг все ніяк не зробить просто цієї можливість доступною для всіх. Тому давайте творіть так, щоб ми були щасливі. Ну, у нас ситуація трохи інша. Тут бути щасливим, ну...
The situation here is a little different. It is not easy to be happy here, given that the fighting is ongoing.
Зрадофільство, капітулянство, агентокремлівство.
Realistic analysis, as you say, is about gentility, capitulation, agenticism, and all the other things that our society distributes, stigmatizes, and declares very, very abundantly and effectively. That's why politicians have to satisfy, among other things, the demand of society for a similar perception of reality. It is difficult, but it is too difficult. Society must accept this, and proper dissemination through the media is essential, but that's not happening. For instance, people cite opinion polls on Ukrainians' foreign policy readiness, claiming Ukrainians are against it. However, where are the Ukrainians in regions like Zakarpattia? Chernivtsi, or central Ukraine, getting their information about the front. In principle, theoretically, we assume that they get information from information sources or from their relatives and friends. But then they turn on a national anti-propaganda resource where they are told, look, everything is decisive good, and tomorrow, well, if not tomorrow, then in the 25th year of Russia's history, we are coming. The outcome remains unclear, yet we will keep advancing. People think, if it's not that bad and we're making progress, why pursue negotiations? This sentiment is reflected in opinion polls, which I question based on my specific social circle. Politicians then argue, look, sociology shows people are against it. But what exactly are people against?
Скажімо, свого кола комунікації, але воно специфічне. Да? І потім політики кажуть, дивіться, соціологія каже, люди проти. А люди проти чого?
Because anti-propaganda resources explain that everything was fine and victory was coming. This is a vicious circle, where, for example, those who refer to sociology form this sociology themselves, not in terms of falsification, but in terms of creating a public mood, because there is no public opinion, but there is a public mood. Okay, if we then come to this topic from the other side, how is the public mood measured? Or how does the kind of news we are going to talk about affect this public mood? Over the past week, perhaps even over the past week and a half, news has been coming out very intensively that foreign arms companies are entering the Ukrainian market to support the Ukrainian military-industrial complex. Companies as diverse as Environment, which is developing the Switchblade 3600, to companies that manufacture parts for Leopard tanks, are planning domestic production to be sold in Ukraine. Perhaps some of the products will be exported. Initially, it may be certain spare parts, and later it is possible to expand the production of 155mm shells.
Це ж все робиться завдяки іноземним компаніям, які зараз заходять до нас на ринок. Якщо вони це роблять, значить ситуацію вони за нас.
This is all happening thanks to foreign companies that are now entering our market. If they are doing this, it means that they do not take the situation too critically, because opening new production facilities means time, money, and investment. It is very costly, because it will be difficult to take away what they have built. Look, we actually have, again, in terms of news, for example, Switchblade. First of all, we are talking about component assembly. And in the first stages, I think they are planning to do this for a year or two. Then they may start to manufacturing components, and then the entire production line. But the entire production line is somewhere in the third stage. What do we have now? We have a workshop where the imported components will be used to assemble what is in demand in Ukraine and what our government will probably buy under long-term contracts.
Відповідно, якщо в тебе є можливість зекономити на собівартості по логістиці.
If you can save on costs, logistics, and labor, which is cheaper in Ukraine than in the US, along with favorable taxation, you can significantly reduce expenses. Setting up production is also low cost, requiring only a hangar and a contract for 2 to 3 years for a specific volume. While we may not know all the details, this is the essence of the business model.
Ми цього всього не знаємо, але плюс-мінус так працює бізнес-модель. І ти розумієш, що за 2-3 роки ти окуповуєш всі свої інвестиції.
You realize that in 2 or 3 years you will recoup all your investments. Plus you will have invaluable experience of direct communication with those who use these drones or attack drones. You pursue this project for its profitability, the ability to withdraw capital and profits.
Виведення капіталу і прибутку з цього виробництва.
Why not? I don't see any problems at all. But is it a matter of complex production? And is it a matter of creating a significant number of jobs? So far, the question remains open. In terms of shells, missile programs, and so on, we have a systemic and constant demand. We buy weapons, and once we buy them, we will work on improving them after the war is over. This is a matter of entering a market where there is an opportunity to make money, because we are not charity workers. Plus, later on, the development or the same shells that will be produced here will hopefully become a raw material base for gunpowder and other components. They will go to fill the warehouses of Eastern and Central Europe. But at the same time, they can also be releasing. In Ukraine, certain types of metallurgical enterprises are relocated to Poland. Zaporizhia, I know a few enterprises for sure, so it's not that difficult to take an enterprise or relocate it if it's not complicated. These are not lithography plants that need to be transported from Taiwan. They even require 2 years to prepare a site in the United States to conduct seismic surveys, understand how earthquakes occur there, drive piles, and prepare the foundation. This process takes time, and we have no issue relocating an enterprise to Poland if our businesses are also moving. People go where they earn money and sell goods, as these are essential for their daily lives, funded by the Ukrainian state budget. I don't see any symbolic meaning here. They believe there is a stable market.
Тому люди йдуть туди, де платять гроші, і де їх товар збувається, в першу чергу. Ну, а тут збувається, бо...
Obviously, they understand that for a certain period of time, at least, even if tomorrow we announce that the first round of negotiations is somewhere in the offing, the fighting will not end for at least another year. The legal regime of martial law will not end immediately either. The most important thing is that in the future, the arming of the army will be the responsibility of Ukraine itself, with its capabilities, and not so much with the help of our partners. They follow the process and the demand. This is really baffling to me from the point of view that the specialized publications that write about the entry of foreign arms companies into the Ukrainian market are making an extremely powerful step. I have even read comparisons with West and East Germany. But for me, this is a positive step, even though I don't understand the essence of these comparisons.
З тієї точки зору, що
When a company comes in, I understand that they are investing money, they are ready to relocate, but as we have just discussed, it is not too difficult when it is a small business that does not have the resources to relocate. It will have to close, and that's the end of it.
Я сприймаю це як позитивний крок, але я не розумію суті оцих порівнянь, суті того, що коли заходить компанія, я розумію, що вони вкладають гроші, вони...
When one of the largest arms manufacturers in the world comes in, closing or relocating its production business, not even a production line, but small components, is a snap of the fingers, and it doesn't even lose anything. So I don't know if this is the first good first step, but there is still a lot of work to be done. Look, we welcome such initiatives in any case. I agree with you, it's more than we had before, because there was almost nothing before. At the same time, you can't make a mountain out of a molehill, you know, and say that components or repair shops for foreign harrowing equipment are already a production line.
Такі ініціативи, я з тобою згоден. Це більше, ніж було раніше, да? Ну, або вірніше, раніше не було майже нічого. Водночас, ну, треба, ну, не можна з мухи робити слона. Ніж і сказати, що компоненти чи ремонтні майстерні для іноземної бронетехніки – це вже виробнича лінія.
We cannot say that we will be turning out barrels in Ukraine, because they actually take quite a long time to make. I once read a publication about Caesars, and there is a certain limited number of them that can be produced in a year. When we talk about 155mm shells, we need to understand whether we are getting components delivered to us and assembling them, like a Lego set, or whether we are producing each stage on our own. The production lines can carry out installation and commissioning, and in fact, somewhere in a dungeon in western Ukraine, we have a complete closed cycle with the ability to increase production. These are different things. If we are talking about gunpowder, there are also problems here because this is a raw material that we do not have and we import it or bring it in specific ways. As far as I know, in the case of gunpowder, there is a situation where Turkey can be useful to us, but it is not because it has cooperation with the aggressor country and earns more with it. This is a complex, multi-component production that used to be scattered across different territories as part of globalization, so there can be no complete closed cycle at all stages. But the equipment is complex, and it is unlikely that Patriots will be assembled here, or that someone will transfer the license to assemble Leopards or Hymers. Plus, you also need to understand the skills, because if the company faces the fact that they don't have turners, or welders, those people who work with a high level of skill in the production of military products. These people are also, to put it mildly, not 10 people in every house who are not employed. They are already employed. Some of them are mobilized, some are relocated. That is, they have left to work in other countries.
Вони вже зайняті, частина з них мобілізовані, частина з них релоковані.
In order for a more complex degree of added value to work in the production of military industrial complex products, you also need trained personnel. When we talk about a strike drone or a kamikaze drone, we don't assemble FPVs in garages or factories. Small FPVs are assembled from components from China. Not all components are produced here. But they are assembled. How does Sweetblade differ from FPV or more complex modern Ukrainian developments in terms of assembly? This is in terms of assembly, not in terms of design documentation, intellectual property, in terms of our own 3D models that are prepared, certified, and patented for their use. We like to exaggerate in the information space where it is worth noting positive movement, but it is important to understand that there is still room for improvement and everything is still ahead. In January, especially in January, Andriy, Thank you for the conversation, and thank you to our viewers for watching this far. We will say goodbye until tomorrow, because we will see you again tomorrow morning.
Попрощаємося до завтра, тому що завтра
See you soon.
Побачимося знову. До зустрічі.
До зустрічі.